It's a pleasure to welcome Eyal Weizman to speak here. Although we've now finished the educational symposium, somehow we still seem to continue drawing upon the vast pool of talent and potential lecturers from what, I don't know what you call them, the Salon des Refusés at the AA in its kind of recent period. It was almost a moment when we would speak of the disappeared of Bedford Square. Eyal was a student here, an immensely witty and inventive student who had extremely talented projects. He was also an architect who at that time frequently was working for Zvi Hecker in Berlin. Since that time, he was compelled to teach at the Bartlett, but it seems not to have done him any great harm. And he's developed his own kind of professional practice, not with any great ease, since also his work in Israel has been a kind of profound concern with the politics and consequences of the Israeli occupation of the West Bank. And Eyal has really conducted a kind of both research practice. He was registered to do a PhD at the London Consortium, where one of his supervisors was the late Paul Hurst, who had a special interest in the work that Eyal was doing. And the work that he's done on the West Bank really has enormous kind of potential to kind of reconfigure, I mean, at a theoretical level, to reconfigure the sense of the spatiality of occupied territories and the way in which traditional military and security conceptions are really irrelevant in a contemporary period. Eyal's work shows that traditional, what you might call military strategy, which is almost, and security, which is almost entirely a kind of two-dimensional issue, is one which has to give way in the case of the current organization, Israeli organization of the West Bank, into the invocation of a third dimension of sort of verticality. That's one way of putting it. Eyal continues to lecture widely through the world. He's become extremely valued in a number of universities in the States, and I'm very pleased that he's now a visiting professor at the Vienna Academy. It's an enormous pleasure that I welcome Eyal back to give a lecture. Eyal.
Well, thank you, Mark, for this really generous introduction. And obviously, I'm really pleased to be speaking here. I kind of know this hall from the other way. And I think, as a matter of fact, probably most lectures I heard in my life were in this hall. But I think that today I would like to start that lecture with a particular strand of my research now, and that is about an architectural education of a different order, and point our attention to a parallel world which exists right now to that of architecture students at the AA, at the Bartlett, in America, in several universities, trying to conceptualize, understand cities, urbanism, from a really kind of positive sort of point of view, with agendas of congestion and a celebration of a kind of multi-layered, multicultural urbanism, and say that today, actually, most urban research that is conducted worldwide is done by men in uniform. And that recently, and when I say recently, in the past 5 years, a series of universities, if we can call it like that, have been set up in military context around the world, where soldiers are sitting and learning a very similar curriculum to ours. I'm not sure if I can have the right, if that is coming up. Recently, in the past few months, I've started an analysis where I have traced those urban practitioners, right? Those people that are thinking about cities now from a military security perspective, and conducted a series of interviews with them. It was a very sort of initially kind of a naive curiosity to realize how does the military sees the contemporary city? How does it conceptualize it? How does it understand the city on all its sort of complicated layers? And as I said, conducted that archive of interviews with generals, most of them Israelis now, because as you know, so much of urban thinking has been developed throughout the last intifada in the West Bank and Gaza, and somehow Israeli generals are now at the forefront of that kind of transformation in a military perception. So, and that is how I imagine and wanted to start that lecture today, by actually showing you that string of interviews, only that since I've showed that in Ramallah a few days ago, I just came back, and the transcription of that has appeared in Israeli news, I kind of lost my authority to show that, those series of interviews, only that there is one which was left, which is done by a retired brigadier general, right? His name is Shimon Ave, and since he's not on uniform, I can show you a small bit of that interview. This was a public event, and it was a discussion between both of us, and I asked him, Brigadier General Shimon Ave, what is your curriculum? Actually, what do you guys read in your school?
Christopher Alexander, can you imagine for John Forster, other architects, we're reading Gregory Bateson, we're reading Clifford Geertz, not myself, our soldiers, our generals are reflecting on this kind in fact, we, as I said, we have developed a curriculum which trains operational architects. Well, we established a school, an institute that in fact is doing this kind of research, develop these kind of ideas, not only ideas, methods of work, methods of thought. We have developed a method of thought that very much resembles, and we departed from pretty much the same logic that architects employed. We have developed a method of thought that trains generals to look to conceptualize the rival's culture. You must be first and foremost able to conceptualize the logic of the rival. In this respect, you must be able to conduct cultural voyages into different territories. Well, we try to do that.
I guess that It must be as surprising to you as it is to me to see, besides the kind of Christopher Alexander and those sort of almost like prehistorical kind of architectural urban text, there is a variety of other readings. And that is actually the first slide from that lecture, right? Between difference and repetition, right? Postmodern, anarchists, nomadic terrorists, formless rival entities. I think that when we look at the categories and the way that the military conceptualizes it, we realize that it is the same theory that we are reading, right? That's as much as kind of as theory goes, but that man, obviously, being today one of the foremost kind of architectural teachers in that parallel world that I was discussing, actually, you know, he goes to architectural bookshop, picks up the kind of the latest readings. He knows as well Rem Koolhaas and the Lagos project very well. So in that term, the way that that the military projects and try to understand the Arab city through kind of the Israeli perspective that has now been exported worldwide, and you know that today, while the Battle of Fallujah is still happening, the kind of the theory and methods that were developed in the West Bank are being applied in that area. Still, I'm showing slides which are not from my lecture, but from the general's lecture about kind of complex coordination of a maneuver form that the military calls swarming. Right? I don't know if you remember kind of the school of fish of Jeffrey Kipnis here a couple of years ago, and sort of the ideas of complexity theories that are involved in some of those theories. Swarming is basically requiring a complete dematerialization of the military as a linear, solid institute. And basically the kind of the fragmentation of it into semi-autonomous units that are in high coordination between themselves to conduct complex maneuvers and that are enabled exactly from and through a different understanding, right? And you hear that, and the kind of lectures that I couldn't have come to you today are generals actually understanding the city as a liquid entity through which they can move and that they could rearrange through battle. The method that allows them to do it is a way of maneuver through the density that does not accept the alleys, the roads, or any of the syntax of the Arab city and actually carves their own sort of wormholes between homes, right? So you have a whole division actually attacking a Palestinian town, well, Palestinian or here today Fallujah, as I heard that that particular method is being appropriated now by the Marine Corps, and moving between home to home while cutting holes in walls, right? As you move through, and those things are working three dimensions. Another kind of technology that the military is developing now is the ability to see through walls. And I think that while actually studying and tracing those technologies that are being developed, And if we believe history, that one of the greater forces of modernization are actually the civilianization of technologies, I think that particular technology that allows the military to see through wall, in a sense to unveil the last barrier of privacy within the city, the wall, moving through it, seeing through it, shooting through it, is allowing a completely different conception of the city that we should kind of be aware of. Here again, you see this operational maneuver, again, not my slide, the slide of the general, where the dotted lines actually move through the fabric rather than outside on the streets. And in that respect, I want to discuss with you today two categories that I think are essential for my work that are tracing kind of the military logic of the occupation and those processes of civilianization. And both of them are temporality and flexibility. And I think that When we think of frontier regions and the kind of speciality that they have, we must understand that we are not speaking about static spaces, about fixed spaces. And therefore, many of the theoretical categories of writing and conceptualizing the relationship between space and power, right? That kind of poses mainly the city as a kind of as a hierarchical, solid element that the way to transgress and to revolt against is always by action, is always a kind of the clear dichotomy between the world of static things and a world by which action in itself reconfigures space is not suitable to actually conceptualize as an area undergoing fast conflict. Because in the West Bank, every action is space. Everything that you do, every action actually draws and reconfigures the boundaries of the environment that we are talking about. And therefore, that image, which is a kind of perhaps one... sorry, I don't know whose that is, but probably it's... again. Sorry, I think it's you, actually. sorry to be too so direct. I think that the relationship between space and action allows us to see that map, which is a product or part of a product of a human rights research that I've done together with a human rights organization called Btselem, where we were commissioned to actually see planning and architecture as in the West Bank as categories that violate human rights and international law. We've drawn that map. But as a matter of fact, the area was transforming underneath us in such a fast way that could be only kind of one still shot in a constantly evolving animation, where, as a matter of fact, every action, say, a young settler takes a caravan and places it on a hilltop, squeezes and transforms, bends and deforms the borders of space that are actually kind of always shifting and always breathing as they are. And what you see here, in a sense, and I haven't yet, I don't think it's relevant, particularly at that point of the lecture, to go through that drawing and show what is what on it. But basically what you see are the boundaries of different legal categories within the West Bank, those flexible boundaries. Now, if we accept flexibility as the category of our analysis of that space, we have to, this allows us to actually read backwards from the drawing, from the map, and understand the political, social, military, economical forces that have created that sort of composition as it is now, right? Because if those are weak forms, and if those are affected and changed by those forces, the information of that forces exists within that form. And therefore, the human rights report that we've done came to turn around those research categories. We said we are not coming from a kind of historical perspective, but from a formal analysis that will read those forces and within those drawings, we can see the actual crimes. We can see the breaches of human rights and international law on those by reading the forms themselves. Now, I'm sure that most of you know the history. I said I will not go through history, but I think that we have to start with a historical episode in order to understand the origin of the settlement project as it exists today. And you see here on the left is a map of Israel during the Six Days War. Everything here within this light beige sort of area is Israel within its internationally recognized borders. Those are the 1949 ceasefire line, which are intensely arbitrary, right? And that was something that has plagued Zionism throughout, between 49 and 67, that the border was not a border. It was just cutting arbitrarily through hills and valleys, through villages and towns. It was seems like a kind of a temporary ceasefire line of a kind of an exhausted campaign rather than a clearly defined a border. Therefore, in the 6 days war, with the complete collapse of the Arab armies that were facing Israel, a preemptive attack on 67 allowed the IDF to choose new borders, right? And the choice of the new borders was not only strategic, but it kind of resonated with the phantasmagorical attitude that was prevalent in Israel at the time, and that was the completing of the project. A kind of a search for the complete form that would give a recognizable sort of body politic, right? And therefore, Israeli, the military has redeployed along the Jordan River, along the Suez Canal here, and along the line of volcanoes here in the Golan Heights. These were all sort of liquid borders, right? In the sense that they were either rivers or canals in that respect, and gave a kind of an edge to the spatial imagination of the Israeli state at that time. But at that moment, and you know in military theory, the moment of occupation is as well a moment of defense, right? You occupy an area and you have to fortify to defend that particular form that you have redrawn by your military is a moment of a kind of a paradigm shift within Israeli history. And I think that that moment is really clearly explained by that image. And that is really the moment where that paradigm shift happens. There's a young general that arrived to the Southern Command. I don't know if any of you can recognize. This is Ariel Sharon in 1971, speaking here to the old man, the ubiquitous sort of old man of Israeli politics and strategy, Ben-Gurion, right? And what Sharon is saying at that meeting here, and that is the beginning of the kind of fragmentation of the idea of the borders, is that linear fortification would never work, right? So that idea of drawing the precise line and keeping a static form, because the idea of the completion of the project and the drawing of that perfect body politics implied eternity, right? It was those borders were done to last. And here, along the Suez Canal, and this is a drawing that I have of, again, by the Israeli military, it's the fortification system of the Suez Canal in 1971. The idea was to build that incredible earth dike, right, which is here all along the Suez Canal, which implied the shuffling of a huge quantities of sand from all across Sinai and piling it up to 30-meter-high earth dike, which was a brilliant idea at the time, because the Israeli generals imagined that if you think about the Western Wall or the Todd Line, those fortifications made of concrete, there's always a bigger bomb that can penetrate thicker concrete, whereas sand absorbs any blast, right? And while still keeping its form. So the idea was that it is impossible to remove those quantities of sand. But what Sharon was said, that however, and any line could be breached. And if the idea of linear fortification implies that if you cut it at a single point, the whole length is immediately useless, right? It's much like a leaking glass of water. It can be tight. With one hole, it is rendered completely useless. Sharon was saying that basically, in order to fortify the state, he wanted to conduct what he called a matrix of dynamic defense in depth, right? And that was kind of his fortification idea, which implies, again, the fragmentation of the army from a single solid hierarchical position into a semi-autonomous units, which were placed each on the hilltops that were overlooking the canal plain, and actually separated. That matrix was operating by each point being in flat trajectory, fire distance from each other, with roads to each other, as with electromagnetic communication. And the idea is that with that system of fortification, if one point falls, the matrix could always form new connection along across its depth, right? It's a dynamic system of defense that denies stable borders. And in a sense, what it does is replace space with time. It allows the enemy to progress into the matrix, uses the time for reorganization, and traps him within that sort of complex dynamic system. So that was the idea of Sharon. Obviously, the Israeli generals, which at the time were the labor generals, right? In Israel, you know, the generals are politically affiliated from sort of the rank of general. A belief in the static permanence of the border, again, allowed them to build that. But nobody counted on a quite ingenious idea that the Egyptian military had in 1973, where just finishing to build the Aswan Dam in Upper Egypt and using water cannon to displace these huge quantities of sand has actually melted the line rather than attack it with fire, created holes, and within a day managed to position 100,000 soldiers on its other side. So from that day, from the 6th of October 1973, the idea of stable line, stable form, and linear fortification is dead in Israeli, both strategically and politically. The actual political implication of that war and the vindication of Sharon's fortification strategy, which is deemed to have stopped the Egyptians, et cetera, allowed the Likud to come back to power in 1977. Okay, so the next election, they use the war as a proof for the inability of Israel's traditional labor movement politics to protect the state. Sharon becomes the minister in charge of settlement, and does to the Jordan River what he's done to the Suez Canal, right? Basically, he says, and here he's explaining to Caspar Weinberger on one of the hills of the West Bank, the idea of a matrix of fortification in depth. Just as an anecdote as well, the American military, who was the military that was studying that battle more than anyone else, as well adopted and changes a whole system of European fortification during the Cold War into the matrix in depth. And if anybody of you now drives along Western Germany, you see those bases that are working in that matrix, and many of them now become the sort of EasyJet sort of airport that were part of that that part of the American matrix that was, in a sense, the replay of Sharon's idea for the Sinai. In any case, the actual translation in the Israeli political strategic imagination of the 73 war, the Yom Kippur war, onto the settlement project meant that settlements were thought of as fortification, right? And that settlements, now civilian, suburban, were actually seeded here in that matrix across the West Bank according to the same principles, overlooking the main arteries, always the kind of the visual supervision, electromagnetic and road communication between them, right? That create that matrix that was supposed to protect Israel from that phobia of a sort of an Eastern Jordanian-Iraqi coalition that would enter into Israel through the West Bank and bisect the country, right? This is, the settlement project was a response to that. Now, I think that there is one principle in international humanitarian law that needs to be discussed in order to understand the issue of temporariness that is so crucial to that project, right? The 1907 Hague Regulation, you may know, one of the first international convention to regulate the rules of war and make it more civil and kind of protect civilians as much as possible. Obviously, a convention that Israel has signed and accepted and internalized into its law does give some allowances to an occupying army in occupied area. So you are allowed, as an occupying army, to do temporary military fortifications in response to temporary urgent need. Right? Therefore, it is allowed, according to international law, for the British Army to fortify itself in Belgium, right? To dig itself in and to seize private fields. All on the basis of temporariness, that means at the time the war is over, you would actually give back the land and compensate the private owner of it, right? So there is a suspension of some political, human, and property rights that are allowed temporariness during a state of war. So actually projecting the settlement project as a response to war threats allowed Israel, exactly according to that mechanism, to seize land based on temporary military needs, right? But if the imagination of the European imagination of the signatories of the Hague Regulation understood war as a temporary state of exception within a history of peace, a history of permanent peace that is breached by war, and then the common history of peace returns, frontier wars can never be understood in that form. Frontier wars are always an ever-present, low-intensity conflict that are no war, no peace. And so by actually principle actually empties out the whole understanding and provision of that particular regulation. So settlements are temporary, and that is the beginning of the settlement project, sort of temporary urbanism being dropped on site by trucks, sometimes through helicopters if there is no road. So the whole matrix has been laid out before any consolidation, right? As a skeleton project of the occupation, in anticipation that each one of those seeds would later grow into kind of an urban or suburban community. Right? So they all start, and today when we hear about the outpost, each and every settlement in the West Bank has started as an outpost. So therefore the military could go to the Israeli Supreme Court, say, take a private Palestinian field and say, well, we have an urgent security needs, bring the generals to testify as expert witness. The Supreme Court would actually have no other choice but to authorize the construction of the settlements until the settlers themselves contested that very category of temporariness. So the kind of the changing consciousness within Israel that has happened after 1977, where different messianic strands start to be much more apparent and explicit within Israeli politics, meant that the settlers themselves would not accept the temporality or the temporary occupation of land, and would not accept strategic need as the imperative, but divine right. And the government had a problem because the settlers themselves started to come to the Supreme Court and say, who said it's temporary? We are here to stay. This is the land of our forefathers, and therefore another mechanism had to to come in exactly when those settlements, those big suburbs such as Maaleh Edomim here, between Jerusalem and Jericho, are starting to be built. If anybody of you has been to Israel, knows that the borders of Israel prior to the 67 occupation describe rather, or pretty much 80% of them are the lower valleys and the coastal plains. Right? Israel, within its internationally recognized borders, is a flat country. The 67 war has brought the mountain as a cultural category, political, strategic category, into the Israeli public political and military debate. Right? Architects of kibbutzim, who needed the plains in order to build agricultural settlements, did not know how to build on the mountains. Right? There was this problem. There was a lot of experience of how to build actually rather abstract forms in the plain rather than knowing how to build on the mountains. And a very important guidebook titled by the Ministry of Construction and Housing, titled How to Build on a Mountain Terrain, was published in 1984. which is, in effect, a guidebook for architects of how to build settlements in the West Bank, as well in the Galilee, at that particular time. And that was the first time that architects actually entered the project of occupation, right? You don't need architects to put the caravans in a circle or to seed them across the matrix. You need military planners. But the minute architects enter into the equation, the whole language of observation, surveillance, and matrix that our military categories have to go a process of civilianization, right? So if we understand vision and surveillance as a strategic category, and we know that those points on the matrix were put there in order to survey, to overlook the traffic artery, to overlook the strategic crossroad, to overlook that Palestinian village which is threatening, at that moment, vision for architect became a kind of an aesthetical category that lost, or seemed to have lost, its military imperative. And here, kind of one of the first drawing in that book, actually showing architects that before they lay out the first building, the directions of view have to be set up, right? There is no building. But we need to look at that direction, at this direction, and that direction, which forms the matrix, and overlooks that Palestinian village, which is, for the military, is exactly that target, this object of surveillance, but for architects had to turn through and become that kind of pastoral, perhaps biblical, object of contemplation, right? So the architects themselves, they don't acknowledge and they don't accept them being a part of a military master plan. And when you read and go over the brochure that lure settlers into Israel, into the West Bank, actually what you read most commonly is come to the West Bank into this pastoral biblical landscape where you can view the landscape of our forefathers, the biblical landscape, and enjoy pastoral calm, right? And then you understand that moment of transformation where, and you ask yourself, what exactly is biblical about that landscape? And the brochures tell you, it is the olive orchards, it's the stone terraces, it's the man on the donkey, it's kind of the dust pathway, it's everything which Palestinian daily life actually create, which becomes that sort of pastoral view that you come in order to replace, right? So there is a kind of a complete contradiction along that axis of supervision, admiration, and then the settlers, the settlements themselves actually solidify those vision, those trajectories of vision into an urban form that is in effect a visual surveillance device, right? The layout of that settlement obviously in a very sort of panopticon-like manner, only kind of inside out, as it is surveys the outside, each house overlooks a particular and different angle of the panorama. The houses in the second ring overlook between the gaps of the first ring and creating that surveillance machine, whereas the inward-facing gaze, and that is all principles that are built into that 1984 guidebook that tells you to direct the bedroom windows into the center where the communal life of the settlement is actually surveyed and protected. But in a sense, this inner facing gaze is that which creates, is this kind of ideologically the settler mentality. You know that most settlers come to the West Bank as to improve their quality of life rather than from ideological reasons, but they go a process of becoming ideologized through living in those mechanisms that regulate the kind of a social conformity to particular religious ideas through urban form, right? And here I think in those two kind of allegorical images, one from a film I'm working on with Nadav Arel, and the other one, Benjamin Netanyahu and Ariel Sharon, actually overlooking the landscape that shows you the very different relation to the landscape that between the kind of the labor or the left in Israel and the right, where the left kind of, the landscape for it is a resort, agricultural resort, and for the right it's this visual resort that is just there to be seen rather than to be touched, right? Now what happened when that landscape, that pastoral biblical, starts shooting back at you, when the man on the donkey actually stops and take a gun from it, and that Bible actually starts resisting? Here in the settlement of Gilo, which is a neighborhood of Jerusalem, a wall that has actually replaced that landscape with an artistic impression of it. And within that drawing actually is cleansed the Palestinian from the view, right? You see there is no Palestinians anymore on that idealized landscape that the settlers want to see. Now, we were talking about the fact that the principle of the 1907 Hague Regulation was no longer applicable to the occupation, since the settlers themselves did not accept the category of temporality, temporariness. And a different category had to kick in, and a different sort of legal strategy had to now guide and lead the settler project as a colonization project. And that is a kind of a very manipulative reading of the 1858 Ottoman land law. Now, I guess some of you probably know that in 1858 there was a big land reform within the Ottoman Empire, where for the first time in the history of that empire, there is a category of private land, private property, whereas previously there was all kind of the lands of the Sultan or the Pasha, etc. Now, that reform has given each farmer in the Ottoman Empire possession of the land that he cultivated. So if he could have proven continuous cultivation of that land was his. And all the areas that were uncultivated were actually seized back by the state or the Sultan into a kind of category of state land. Right? Now, by using that category, Israel has been able to actually take... Now, well, you know that an occupying country must accept the land regime, or the land law, that exists within an occupied area. And that law was integrated into Jordanian law from which the West Bank was occupied. And therefore, Israel could have actually used it legally, that mechanism. And what you see here, all these sort of thousands of islands and peninsulas and archipelagos, is actually the borders of one single regional council in the West Bank, right? So if we understand the borders of political, of sort of coherent political areas as continuous and solid, what happened here is that every bit of land within that border is in effect and de facto Israel, whereas every area outside of it is occupied area where the laws of emergency apply. So you have the border fragmented and actually being everywhere across the territory. Now, how that was created, if you think about mountain regions, the alluvial soil, meaning the good agricultural soil, erodes always from the mountaintop and onto the valley. So the valleys are cultivated and the mountaintops are barren. Therefore, if you think of that thing as a kind of a horizontal section, right? Imagine a kind of topographical a model of a mountain. You cut it at 600 meters. Everything which is above it is Israel. Everything which is below it is an occupied area. You understand that verticality start playing in and start becoming a very important category in order to understand the spaces and the functioning of that environment, right? And here, if we go back to the map that I've done for Btselem, you see that everything within that blue being, in effect, state of Israel land on which Israeli law apply, and here again, emergency land, where the law of emergency apply, the settlements themselves here marked in sort of the dark blue stains on the map have to squeeze in to fit within that very complex boundaries, which are the boundaries of possible, right? And here you see it very clearly. The valley is cultivated, you see the fields. The mountainside is completely terraced with olives, and the mountain top was barren, seized, and immediately a settlement is on top of it, right? That, in effect, is Israel that is the Palestine or this, or kind of the emergency zone of occupation. And this is how it kind of work on every moment within the West Bank, you have that border. Here you see this settlement, Ephrata, south of Jerusalem, could not have seized those lands as they were cultivated by the settlement itself, right? Not this. If you can imagine, that image would normally be understood as these are the fields of these people, right? But actually it's the opposite. These are Palestinian fields which limit and morph and change the form of the settlements that cannot be built on any sort of cultivated area. And so what Israel does very often is to plant those pine trees. And you know something which is very particular about pine is they have this acidic drop on the ground that does not allow any bushery or anything to be cultivated in that area years after they are cut, right? So Israel would plant those olives in order almost like to poison a bit of land and to reserve it for future expansion of the settlement here, that settlement, again, Maale Edomim, whereas Palestinian sort of cultivation is seen as a sort of the marking the borders of privacy, of kind of their private land, no? And maintaining cultivation as an act of resistance, almost blocking, as you see here, the expansion of the settlement. Sometimes you even see pockets and islands of private Palestinian field within the settlement itself, fragmenting kind of its form and its formal coherence. Now, just quickly about that project and how I entered into that research is that about 5 years ago, a human rights group came to my office in Tel Aviv and proposed that we conduct a human rights research on human rights and international law violation for planning and architecture. What we didn't have that time is a precise map showing where things are. And if you understand mapping as a form of political critique, the map that the Israeli left, those who were resisting the occupation, had before was a Peace Now map. Peace Now is a political organization that resists the occupation based on, again, another provision, the 49 section of the Geneva Convention, that says an occupying country may not transfer parts of its population into an occupied area, right? So basically, according to that political perspective, any settlement anywhere in the West Bank is already a violation of international law, and there is no need to research the form and the kind of the formal implication and effects of the very organization of matter and form across the landscape. We have accepted that. We have accepted that it's already a crime to build within the West Bank, but wanted to look at another order of the crime, and that is the way that settlements are actually violating human rights. So from a human rights perspective, the principle of the Geneva Convention was not enough, and we needed to see the effect of form on on daily life of Palestinians. Therefore, we had to draw this map just quickly. Everything which is blue here, again, is are the settlements. Light blue is the area where they expand to, areas within their master plans. Everything with, in brown are built Palestinian fabric, and in light spectrum of browns are areas under Palestinian control, limited control, area A and B, right? So when we were doing that human rights research, we've taken the case study of Ariel, the biggest settlement in the western part of the West Bank, as our case study, and actually asked ourselves why the settlement looked like it does, right? Why is it so long and thin? And comparing it to other settlements that would have the same kind of distance from Tel Aviv, say, which is where that suburban settlement relate to, and they're all very compact, try to be round, you know, suburban settlements as they do. So there are a set of forces which actually operate on that form, which are not in order to serve its own population, right? And we were kind of trying to break that formative forces into trying to stretch itself as long as thin along Route 505, which is one of it's the Trans-Samaria Highway, one of the main strategic roads. But more importantly, it kind of does that banana form in order to cut Salfit, which is a regional Palestinian town, from its regional economy here, Zeta Jama'in, Kifl Haris, etc., Isawiya. And those settlements are actually being cut off from their bloodline, which is the commercial center of Salafid, by the very form of the settlement. So here we were able to identify a crime that was done on the drawing board, and to actually try to implicate that architect who has drawn, that planning office that has drawn that plan, in war crimes. Obviously, we were not yet successful for several reasons we can speak about later, but that was the intention of showing exactly how the settlement project moves from points on a matrix, and here you see the incremental growth diagram of Ariel, growing from points into that sort of form, that sort of stain, that operate in order to violate human rights and in breach of international law, right? This is kind of that moment where the matrix turns into stains, into forms, is kind of the beginning of the biopolitical project of the occupation in the West Bank, where the enemy is understood not to be that which is outside, that mythical phobia of the Jordanian-Iraqi columns that would come to bisect Israel, but that the enemy is already inside. And through form and through the organization of space here, Jerusalem, and the way that the Jewish neighborhoods and settlements try and struggle to isolate and wrap and bisect every Palestinian neighborhood within that city, operate as a mean to effectively limit the Palestinian population of the area. Because if you limit their capacity to live on the land, basically you limit the numbers. And in effect, what you have is what is called in Israel the quiet transfer, right? That is conducted through architecture and planning practices. So, if to just quickly go through the kind of the different home typologies within the West Bank, and I'll go a little bit quicker, is that caravan or kind of ship container that is the kind of the prefabricated unit which is scattered around the landscape, and is in effect what allows the flexibility of space. The very rigidity of the unit allow the always redrawing, the very quick redrawing, contraction and expansion of the territory onto the unit, which is kind of the ideal home, the sort of gesture towards the real estate market that the red tiled roof is, luring the settlements, the settlers into the West Bank, where I think that image by an Israeli photographer called Efrat Shvili really embodies all the contradiction in the colonial project of the settlement. On the one hand, it's this sort of foreign gesture with the red tiled roof. On the other hand, the sort of the stone cladding of the building, which tries to be local, tries to speak about some form of locality, and the sort of the arched door. Well, we are in the Middle East anyway. That are kind of all those gestures that. That make that operates within that piece of architecture. Now, I think that 67 must be understood as well as a kind of an architectural paradigm shift within Israeli housing policy. And you know, everybody that has been to Israel before knows that Israeli architecture in the 50s and 60s are typified by that sort of concrete block, hard-lined, brutalist modernism that is done very much by graduates of that school, that institute, Carmi or Leitersdorf and many others that have studied here under the Smithsons and others. The point is that the minute the occupation takes Israeli culture up the mountain, right? And you have poets writing about the mountains, architects designing the mountains, The initial role of architects within the occupation was actually by leading archaeological excavations, right? And there was the idea that the subterrane is a kind of a national monument that would come to testify for the rights of the Israelis for that land. It's not an occupy, we return. And the proof of the return is under the surface. And if you just peel a little bit this dirt, this sort of unhygienic traces of Palestinian daily life, you will find the ancient kingdom underneath it. And here, I think, in that drawing, you see that, how archaeology literally turns into architecture, and while doing that, replaces the kind of the brutal modernism of the pre-67 period with a kind of post-modernism avant-la-lettre, right? 1968 is the publication of Complexity and Contradiction, the moment where, you know, kind of the canons put it as the kind of the beginning of postmodernism. Well, I mean, it's a blurred line, but still, Israeli architects, without knowing it, start building in traditional forms from the moment of occupation. The whole practice is changing. Well, something very strange happened to Palestinian architecture, coming into contact with Israeli building practices, in effect being those builders of the Israeli homes. The Palestinian architects go up on stilts, right? And kind of modernism become, and there is a kind of replacement, right? Where Palestinians start building in modernist style, and Israelis are speaking about kind of the locality, the idea of a home, the idea of kind of being a part of the landscape. And I think that in those two images you see another order of contradiction where architecture functions as a part of the conflict, but as well where aesthetic categories kind of migrate into within this ecology. Here, an Israeli settlement, it's an Israeli suburb. That is the green line. But might as well, as it looks very much like settlements do, with the typical red roof that has since become a must. So everybody that is building now in the West Bank has to build with red roof, because that is the way that the Israeli Air Force navigate across the landscape, right? Red roof is Israeli, sort of flat roof is Palestinian, only that here you would see across the wall two Palestinian buildings, again this sort of with a flat, perfectly usable flat roof, putting asbestos in a triangle over the roof and painting it red. And you can, there's several ways to understand that that complexity. Either is an act of kind of colonial mimicry that puts the settlement houses, that ideal sort of quality of life signifier, that is that what they don't have, but as well as an act of camouflage, right, in respect to particular sort of military practices across that landscape. And here again, another picture which I like very much, which is a parade in Gaza, right? This is 2002, but still, and it's a part of this growing ritual, growing voodoo ritual, which goes across the now the Middle East, where, you know, the American flag, the Israeli flag, the dolls of George Bush are being burnt as a part of demonstrations. And sometimes you kind of, you come to ask yourself, where do you buy an American flag in Gaza if you want to burn one, right? I mean, you cannot just like go into shop and get a flag. I'll have two American flags. Hamas, which is this militant organization, has an art department. And the art department produces those objects. Now, what they've produced here is an architectural model, right? The architectural model, which is a part of a ritual of the conflict, and they're burning the architectural model, where the red roofs here, pink, are kind of are so meticulously sort of represented, and architecture is pitched as the very essence of that conflict, right? Well, I will not speak about that much, but as sometimes it happens, the Palestinian Ministry of Planning kind of consulted me on several things since the map, etc. And they have started to think about the possibility that Sharon is not bluffing. Right? Sharon is not bluffing. They are going to evacuate Gaza. What to do with the settlements in Gaza? Right? And actually, there started kind of a field of architectural fantasy about erasing the settlements and building this kind of Disneyland of Arab Oriental forms, which I found not very interesting or productive in that respect. And I went to look at houses of within the settlement and that were evacuated. This is a house in Sinai. This is one of the two settlements that still exist that were Israeli settlements and now inhabited by Egyptians, right? Now, what happened to the house? Nothing. In effect, when you unplug power from that system, architecture means nothing. Still, it's the red roof house, it's a signifier for the Air Force, it sits in a perfect panopticon function, and people live in it. And nothing bad happened to anybody, right? So in a sense, that reversal, that kind of living second in the house of your enemy, right, is a very sort of productive move that I was proposing, almost begging the Palestinians to consider when we were speaking about it I'm not sure it will be very successful, but we will see. It's an ongoing debate and discussion that we have, and we continued it in Ramallah the other day. Now, I think that it's important to speak about the wall in the context of that the twin categories of temporariness and flexibility. And actually answer the first question that would surely come from here, isn't the wall the final closing of the Israeli frontier? Isn't the wall the solid permanent line? And I would argue actually that not. Initially, the seizure of Palestinian land in order to construct the wall exactly rely on the same 1907 Hague principle in the Hague Convention, which says we actually seize it for temporary security needs, and when, but that may be a bluff of the occupation, right? But when you start looking at the particular path that the wall is taking, you realize that there is nothing more flexible than that wall. And in a sense, you can start reading backwards. According to the same category that I was mentioning at the beginning of the lecture, each of the twists, turns, bends, and breaks within the path of the wall into a kind of a political, micro-political initiative. So that is an index for the forces that were operating on that wall at a particular time. Here, you see it very clearly. The settlers have set up a temporary outpost, And the wall has kind of, you know, went around to include it within, right? Here, I'm not quite sure, but again, whenever it is diverging from its line of maximum efficiency, there is a force that pushes it here and there. Therefore, we can read that force backward theoretically. And the wall has moved from a master planning project, and here is the initial maps that were, this is my recreation of the map as I was kind of tracing annexation orders and interviewing people in the Ministry of Defense of the way that they imagined to do that wall, right? A complete sort of peninsula, kind of a Norwegian fjord with very fragmented borders that completely bisect Palestinian area into isolated territorial enclaves. And understand that finally, what didn't happen in the settlement project, because the image of the settlement was too benign to capture the European public imagination, right? How can you act against those suburbs which we live in any case? They look too harmless. But the wall actually resonated much more with sort of cultural memories in Europe and became a real arena of conflict where a different location, international pressure, Israeli micro-political actions, settlers' pressure, even Israeli nature enthusiasts who believe that the saving of a particular wild field of iris flowers would only be guaranteed if they reroute the barrier to include it within the Israeli, so to say, Israeli side of the barrier, made that line exactly that arena of conflict where everybody was pushing and squeezing it, right? And it was constantly changing, and bits were actually relocated, etc., according to those principles. So if that is what Sharon initially wanted to do, was basically to wrap up each and every Israeli settlement protected by this very meandering of the wall, the public political pressure, together with the act in the Hague Court, which seemed to have no effect but had an incredible effect on Israel, managed basically to push the main part of the barrier west towards the green line. But then unable to accommodate the contradictions that basically both seek to protect each and every settlement while being closer to the green line, these were contradictory sort of vectors of influence, meant that line is shredded into pieces and like splintered worms, started having renewed life, and the wall ceased to be a line and started to be a condition. And what you see is that basically it fragmented into sections that actually create a kind of a peninsula here, not a Palestinian peninsula, but an Israeli peninsula within occupied areas, and that the level, and that the more international community have managed to push the main part of the barrier closer to the green line, the more fragmented the area behind it became. But only that those fortifications now existing in depth are not politically visible. What the international community knows and react against is just the linear, the main part of the barrier, right? Where all these are just let to happen, right? And if that is what Sharon initially wanted to do, this is what's happening more now, where you see the Israeli kind of islands locked within area that may be given back. And here, the kind of the different manifestation, both conceptually, the barrier is broken into a variety of fortification and security apparatuses that are both kind of walls with shoot-through holes, temporary earth dikes, checkpoints, and it's at some point, the fact that these borders are shrinking and expanding continuously and twisting and turning the terrain meant that it a particular moment of time, the Mukata, which is Arafat's headquarter and where he's going to be laid to rest, as I hear, has been whatever was left of Palestine. As a matter of fact, the border shrank from the regional into the architectural. It was the building itself, and then when you remember those images when Israeli bulldozer kind of chipping at the building shrank into the dimension of internal of interior design. It was only the interior capsule of the office which was left as a non-Israeli controlled space. And here you see images of how that open frontier, when you have an open frontier, the whole political body start presenting frontier-like features. And within Israel itself, here an earth dike between Caesarea, kind of a rich Israeli suburb, and Jasser HaZarqa, a Palestinian town, and as well a kind of echoes of the wall. Here the wall in the West Bank, and here the wall around the Green Zone in Baghdad. You see how those kind of images start migrating through a process of military mimicry. The open frontier actually spreads out through the media into other places. But the question is, what do you do when you have a fragmented territory? How do you actually travel? If those people that live in those islands are actually suburban communities, how do they get to Tel Aviv? And at that moment, a kind of invention that refers to what Mark Cousins was saying, the invention of the political third dimension became effective, right? In order to connect the territorial fragments of an undividable territory, of a completely fragmented terrain, you had to take people either over alien territory or under it. In either bridges or tunnels, those islands would now be connected to each other. So that if we see that, and this is a real picture, right? This exists, the tunnel road that connects settlements in Jerusalem past Bethlehem into other settlements, is the first invention of the political third dimension. What it does is that if normally bridges could be understood as things which are actually spanning natural or man-made boundaries like railways or rivers, that bridge is the first one to span over an alien sovereignty. That field is under Palestinian control. The road is Israel, and the international border run between the column and the joint, between the column and the road, in the thermodynamical joint, this is the international border. And then that road, which is still Israel, right, goes here into a tunnel and passes under a whole Palestinian city, Bethlehem, which have Palestinian control, sovereign, limited sovereignty. So you have Palestine over Israel, and then again it goes into a bridge and becomes Israel over Palestine, right? That idea of the political third dimension is a consequence of that territorial overlap and fragmentation which I've described before. Now, if you don't believe that, go into the protocols of the Camp David, the 2000s, of the Doom Convention with Arafat, Barak, and Clinton were actually debating the Temple Mount. And you know, and it's kind of was well documented, that Clinton saw himself as an expert on Jerusalem after reading 2 weeks some travel books about it, but still came up with a rather ingenious solution. Right? He said that in order to resolve that most unresolvable place in the conflict, and you know that historically that the Haram al-Sharif and the Al-Aqsa Mosque is the most holy place for Muslims in Palestine, whereas the temple supposedly under the piazza, the ruins of the temple, the archaeology, the most sacred place to Jews, albeit they cannot be there because it's too holy, it was unresolvable. None of the leader can actually come back to their state, say, I gave up the Haram al-Sharif Temple Mount. And Clinton came up with a bizarre solution. He said, basically, why don't we give the Palestinians sovereignty over the piazza, right? So they have sovereignty over the piazza up to 30 centimeters under it, right? Which is the thickness of the paving stones of the piazza. They're very thick, they're 30 centimeters. Will run the first horizontal international border. Underneath it will be a meter and a half of UN space, right? So that is Palestine. A meter and a half of UN space, so that, you know, they will not be sort of meeting, which is Earth, in a sense. And all the thing underneath it, actually going in a cone shape to the center of the Earth, will be under Israeli sovereignty. And the air over it, suspected to contain heavenly Jerusalem, as well, will be in Israeli sovereignty. So what is created is this insane sort of sovereign Big Mac, where you have Israel, UN, Palestine, Israel on top, and then you ask, how would the Palestinian reach their piazza, their two-dimensional sovereignty, floating and completely wrapped, both on plan and in section by Israel? Again, this kind of sovereign Palestine spanning over the sacred graveyard of the Mount of Olives, right? The idea of partition has to actually come up with those technologies and mechanisms. And here, on a kind of in a grand territorial scale, you see that basically what was offered to the Palestinians, both in Camp David and in Oslo, was just the terrain. Because Israel and Palestine are sitting, as they do, on a huge underground lake called the mountain aquifer, right? That knows no international boundaries, hasn't been informed about 67. And if you actually pump water on one side, they go down on the other side, as water do. So in a sense, the subterranean under Israel and Palestine could not be partitioned, and so is the air. And here you see all the aerial routes on this sort of shared, very narrow airspace. And therefore allowed Israel to kind of to demand both the airways, electromagnetic fields, and the subterranean under Palestine, leaving the Palestinians only the crust of the terrain, obviously only the valleys of the crust of the terrain, because the mountaintops are Israeli. So the whole thing and political issues have been reconceptualized as architectural questions, right? And as you see that those kind of mechanisms, which are the only way to divide the undividable, by actually coming onto the political section. And if you do imagine a two-state solution, meaning a design solution, a design of a line, that there is a line that could divide Israelis from Palestinians, this is what you have to have. The bridges and the Tal are going to be those instruments which will scatter the landscape. You realize that basically that solution is absolutely impossible, right? Territorially and physically, and that the whole political question has been conceptualized as a building, right? Israel and Palestine has been imagined by those architects of war and peace almost like a shopping mall, right? With kind of secluded corridors and multi-layered construction, and in that particular way kind of morphed architecture with geopolitics. So thank you very much.
Questions. Do we have a microphone so that? Yeah, okay.
Good evening. Thanks. Excellent presentation. I'm Stephen Fox. I'm from the London School of Economics, the international lawyer, and our PhD student. So I'm not too. I don't know so much about architectural lexicon. So apologies for that. You didn't seem to mention about this idea of population movements going back into Israel proper, what would be the estimated amount of people who would be prepared to move back? Because in your presentation you said that most of them are not there for ideological reasons, I think something like 20%. A lot of them have gone there for the mortgages and the benefits that they can get. So what's the estimated amount of people who would be willing to go back into Israel proper?
No, I understand this question. What I said is that 80% went there on a non-ideological basis, but I didn't say 80% are still non-ideological. As I was trying to show, the settlement project is a project that, or the architectural part of that project is a kind of, in a way, trying to create to make those non-ideological people ideological. So the minute they may move for an economical reason, by living there, sort of harden them and the community through a series of kind of ritual, both architectural and social rituals, as they are into staying there. I think as well there is something about, I don't know, I heard this joke the other day about a kind of a Serb and a Bosniak sort of, it was two Serbs and a Bosniak sort of going to heaven, right? And the Serb is, and the Bosniak say, well, this is my cloud, and this is my cloud. So one of the Serbs comes and shoot the other one. He says, whenever there's a dead Serb, it's Serbia. So in a sense, that is how it worked, right? The kind of the perpetuation of violence, which acted as a mechanism, the perpetuation of constant violence that perpetuated the state of emergency in the West Bank, it was so effective according to that principle that allows to bypass international law through the definition of a state as a state of emergency, created as well, hardened the population there into being an ideological population. So I think it's a very misleading sort of statistics, as we constantly hear this 80% non-ideologicals, you know. I mean, you try to remove them and you see that they are. Only as well that process could and may be reversed by international bribe, as they are, and the figures for compensation are constantly going up, and they are anywhere between $250,000 per family, depending on obviously kind of the number of years that they've been suffering to live there.
Question. Hang on, there's a mic coming.
You managed to quite clearly show how the division or the partition of the landscape is very ironic or sad, and how it by default is an act of crimes against humanity, but with
not by default, right? Okay. Intentionally,
okay. But with a view to the future, how would you envisage the region? Would you then wish to see an area without partition at all? And also, if you could tell us what you think about the right of return of the Palestinians as part of this possible future solution, right, as you see it.
Right. This is obviously, you ask what I imagine, and I have to go into my own personal politics. It was always favoring a single state, right? And the principle of one man, one state, one vote. And the kind of the Said South Africa model, so to say. But to reach there, you cannot do only what I'm doing, no? And that is to prove that separation is impossible. This is one of the conditions, right? And so much of my work is dealing with actually proving and kind of almost like ridiculizing the politics of separation and the mechanisms and infrastructure of it. There needs to be a desire. There needs to be love, not only hate, no, in that respect. And I think that is the reason why I'm a member of several kind of organizations that are speculating on that solution, which I think is profoundly non-architectural. I think architects have shown their creativity. I think the creativity a la Sharon, yeah, of the tunnels and bridges and the matrix and all that, really, you know, I mean, you have to take the hat down, no? I mean, there is some kind of thought, no? I mean, they were reading, you know, that general, you remember at the beginning, no, reading Deleuze and Derrida and all that? It's crazy. I think there needs to be a profound lack of creativity right now, and say there is no territorial solution. Architects are not a part of that equation, and we have a non-territorial solution, which is a simple principle, which includes a kind of a mechanism to allow the right of return to be exercised in principle or in practice in some sort of way. I mean, I don't want to go very much into the kind of the mechanisms of that, but this is definitely part of the intention. And I think any solution of the problem has to acknowledge the refugee issue. No, I mean, there's no. This is the heart of the issue. And if we speak about temporariness, the refugee camps, both in the occupied area as well as in Lebanon, Syria, and Jordan, are actually the manifestation of the state of emergency and temporariness. Because the fact was that throughout the conflict, Israeli strategy always, and politics always sought, always wanted to transfer the camp into a city, to change that category of temporariness to permanence, and thus to diffuse the refugee problem, which they haven't managed to done so for 50 years. And there's a particular set of planning practices within the refugee camps themselves, and we were there really a couple of days ago in the West Bank in some, that, you know, they don't grow trees in the refugee camps, right? They keep almost like religiously the fact of temporariness as the power, right? The infrastructure, where the shit flows. Is the shit flowing overground or underground? That sort of meter and a half that defines the difference between a temporary, between a city and a camp, right? Is another sort of architectural or infrastructural mechanism to keep that sort of flexible state of temporariness. Obviously, the people who wanted to construct homes, and Sharon was one of the biggest planners, and there's a very big housing blocks in Gaza that he was building for refugees. They refused to move in some cases.
There's a question here.
Thank you for this very critical lecture. My name is Nej Temur. I followed your work 2 years ago at the Berlin conference. Were you there? UIA conference?
No, we were censored out of it.
That's right.
Remember.
And in fact, I just wrote this.
You have an original one?
Yes.
I don't have one anymore.
Oh, I'll give it to you. This I picked up there at the bookshop at the conference. And through UIA, I know the guys in the Israeli Institute of Architects,
They
were very much against your exhibition. And your
work. They censored it, and they burned 5,000 of these.
That's right. So I'm pleased to see that you have developed your work since then.
Okay.
Now, the two questions. One is, what is your relationship with the Institute at the moment?
Well, I cannot, as a matter of fact, it's hard for both Rafi and myself to practice in the country right now.
They refuse. They don't allow you.
No, I mean it's much more complex than that. It's not. They cannot not allow. But obviously they regulate a lot of competitions. So public projects would be more difficult to access. And it is the public sector that we're working for. You know, we built this museum, and we're working for theater, and we were quite popular with a kind of a. Many in the kind of the art section of the public sector in Israel, which are very liberal in Israel, but still it's state money. So there is that problem, whereas the private sector tends to be a bit more conservative, but for them we can work. But who would give us? Who would take us?
Hi, thank you. I find your work very compelling and an innovative approach to looking at power through architecture. I study anthropology at London School of Economics. I'm interested in you were speaking about temporality and flexibility and this, the relationship between space and action. And how borders of space are shifting. And you were talking about the wall as a flexible structure in terms of how it's been developed. Do you think that possibly that looking at this structure in this way as being flexible can also be dangerous in how it guises perhaps the actual tangible impacts it's having as a concrete structure? Like if you look at Kalkilia, for instance, where this area has literally been enclosed, and looking, this, you know, kind of diverting away from the actual tangible concrete and long-term impacts.
Obviously, I think that initially I would say that flexibility and temporariness were kind of celebrated both in architecture and a series of critical disciplines as very positive previously. No, I mean, this, if you're temporary, if you're flexible, this is great. No, I mean, it was kind of... And I think that firstly, one has to say that the relation of space and power through those two categories is much more powerful than through solid space, right? The kind of spaces that, that Lefebvre and Desarteaux imagine. No? Paris is this kind of cities which is a solidification of power, and that we kind of the people can only, you know, kind of subvert it through complex movement through it, but the space itself is there and static. So I think that there is an understanding that flexibility is not a benign term, right? And again, kind of a clarification about these twin categories. What the temporary state of emergency is in time, flexibility is in space, right? They are connected to each other. So I don't think that, you know, perhaps to understand your question or your critique, you still kind of see this flexibility as something which allows for freedom in certain respect. Whereas I do not think so, no? I think that the kind of the liquid power of the occupation and this urban warfare stuff that I was showing at the beginning is much more dangerous. Much more dangerous. Only that we have, there is a possibility in flexibility in a sense that it kind of, what it does, it allows agency to be more diffused, right? And if you think about the difference between a master plan, kind of a one architect or one politician drawing the borders, as in the first route of the barrier, wall, fence type operation, and then you see how actually agency is diffused, right? There's the Israeli nature enthusiast, there is the water engineers, there is the settlers who push it here, there is the Palestinians, there's the international community, and all of them kind of operating within this laboratory of push and pull. That is actually, if there is a liberating thought, it is in that which action can be transformed into space in the West Bank, and your action as an individual can sometimes be as powerful as the agency of a government, right? Sometimes a single suicide bomber, a single sort of raw settler taking a caravan onto a hill is more powerful than the state, right? So it kind of merges geopolitics and direct action in a clear way that allows us to think about ways of resistance through this flexible space. And I think that if there is a liberating potential, it's probably there. And we can discuss the ways of resistance, you know, like planting your olive, right, in a way that would not allow the settlements to progress. And when you don't cultivate it, it does progress. That sort of flexibility. I think that this, if we internalize that category, it could completely reframe the way of resistance, not only in Israel-Palestine, this is a laboratory. It's a laboratory of the extreme, right? But what you see here, you see, you know, kind of gated communities in Orange County or whatever, right? I mean, it's kind of the nightmare scenario of what civilian practices in other places may get to in a few years, right? What it is, it's certain first world kind of, you know, rubbing against each other. And I think that we can learn from it as a warning. And, you know, and clearly in Iraq, where you see that American soldiers are actually copying and mimicking those strategies in the way that they create walls around Iraqi cities within the Sunni triangle, create those temporary roadblocks, enacting, replaying the Israeli occupation in the West Bank there. Of course, there are differences, but I think that there is a value of seeing that case not as a kind of a particularity of a strange local case that has no relevance to anything else, but exactly as a laboratory of the extreme, where actually all the conditions of modernity are kind of against each other, right? Even in architecture, modernism, postmodernism, no archaeology, all those things are stuff that you know that are relevant in from Greece to you know to South America.
Question.
Eyal, I must admit, I actually got only the tail end of your lecture, and I feel really sorry about it. I had one question. You're in a unique position, I think, as an Israeli, taking a critical stance in favor of peace. And among the numerous criticisms and abuse that you must be receiving, let's say, daily, let's say, from the other side, which criticism would you have found, let's say, most difficult to dismiss?
Well, yeah, I mean, first of all, I don't think I'm in a unique position. I think I'm a part of definitely a growing number of Israeli academics or activists and people from different strands who resist that. And definitely I'm not the first one to resist it, and parallel to me there's many people, and after me there'll be many. So I don't see it as a kind of as a point of singularity. As well, don't see myself as working for peace. I'm working towards the kind of to making war more humane, perhaps. I don't believe that, even when we're speaking about the one state, I don't believe that there is a solution as such, you know, that there is a kind of a moment of peace you can strive to. We're talking only about how to manage violence and conflict, no? And if it is the police or the army that deals with that, right? If it is a kind of a question of citizenship or of bilateral relations or kind of barbarian empire relation, you know, I mean, basically kind of regulating these. I don't think that there is a state of peace. What I would criticize myself or accept, you know, I'm so trained to actually bounce back critique, no? Like, I'm conditioned to do that. I'm conditioned, like, to be attacked and to say, you know, and kind of to argue against it. So it's definitely a good exercise for me to do, and I'm sure there are many, many weaknesses in that analysis. I know, for example, that many people, actually from the left and non-architects, are thinking that my analysis is only of one side, right? I only criticize the Israeli occupation, military, political mechanism, and not showing enough Palestinian voices in it. And to them I say, well, I don't speak Arabic, I read Hebrew, and that is my research. And it just kind of, it's put on the table for all of us to put all of our research and negotiate. But if that is perhaps something I would like more to do, is actually, you know, if there is a politics of verticality to kind of to understand a little bit more the kind of the horizontal relations that are happening, and not only to show the maps, but actually the mechanisms and the daily lives and the people behind those and that inhabit those spaces that I describe. But I don't take this criticism.
Okay, sorry, there's one there. We have a mic.
If I understood correctly, your talk was largely predicated on demonstrating that, or refuting the belief that there's a disregard on the part of the Israeli military for the norms of international law, in the sense that demonstrating that there's an incredible effort made to, if not fully complying with the Hague Convention, at least going to extraordinary lengths and contortions to give the image of compliance, and that you positioned yourself as demonstrating that they are one of your primary aims in collaborating with human rights groups, and how you got into this work was to demonstrate that how that appearance is false, that human rights generally are violated. But I wanted to ask why but you also said that you believe that the occupation, that the transfer of population into the occupied territories is a flagrant and gross violation of the Geneva Conventions. And I was wondering why you think it is that the Israeli military and the Israeli political establishment is willing to go to such incredible extremes to at least give create the pretense of complying with the Hague.
I understand the question. It's a very good question. I think that what should have come out from my lecture is that there is no pure power politics, Israeli power politics in the West Bank. It cannot do settlement just where it wants, right? It creates that legal mechanism that it subverts, and finally the form of that settlement that has the fields inside of it shows to the limitation of that power politics, right? Now the reason for it is very simple. Israel is not America. It cannot it had to at least pretend to work on some degree of legitimacy. And therefore, the kind of more, the aspect of rereading, of working, of subverting the law, of reading its loopholes, its weaknesses, and working within it is more effective. And then perhaps it's a bit more Talmudic as well. Just saying, well, I want a settlement here and I will build it. No, you kind of reread the 1858 Jordanian or Ottoman land law together with the 1907 Geneva Hague Convention, and you find this sort of crazy form that would still do what you want, but would kind of textually comply with it. And I think that is what is interesting about the occupation, that that the power politics is not absolute.
Such efforts to create the image, at least, of complying with international norms.
No, I think I was saying that.
Hague mentioned, but why at the same time ignore the restriction against moving a population into an occupied territory.
The moving of population as well has got a kind of a Talmudic reading of that law. Israel doesn't, when the Article 49 of the Fourth Geneva Convention says an occupying country is not allowed to transfer its own population into area it occupies, you need an occupied area to do it. And then Israel says, well, the West Bank is not occupied. Technically, it's never the sovereignty of the Kingdom of Jordan was never recognized on that land. Therefore, you cannot occupy a non-recognized area. So again, there is this sort of reading and loophole seeking and sort of that works. And there is a team. There's a huge team of international lawyers. Some of them, you know, I mean, even, what's his name, Alan Dershowitz, right? Who's advised Israel on the wall. He actually was part of the Israeli team that was trying to look for loopholes, you know, within international law to allow the wall to happen. And I was at the time moderately, you know, I mean, basically I didn't have the chance to kind of to be very much involved, but I was involved in the Palestinian case about the wall. And actually through the same mechanism we were showing exactly, we were drawing the path of the wall, and we were showing not arguing on the principle that it's all illegal, although it is all illegal. We were showing where the legal logic, as it is transformed to form, fails in particular moments, right? Where the temporary security needs are not temporary security needs, but there is another need. So exactly those, looking for those slippages allowed the kind of a bit more sophisticated case to be put in The Hague than just to say, well, it's an occupied land, it's illegal the whole way through. Which finally what won the case, but there was a more sophisticated legal construction, legal territorial construction that was worked on at that time. All right.
Okay, I think we're going to have to finish there for this evening. But I'm sure there'll be many people in the audience who would kind of agree that the lecture raises a number of issues which in themselves, since we've spent 2 weeks talking about what it means that the AA kind of be international, are the kind of issue that really have to be put, you know, not on kind of topics for an evening lecture, but actually part of the educational kind of structure. Anyway, it's for me now to thank Eyal very much indeed. Eyal, thank you.